The city of Tenochtitlan is itself as big as Seville or Cordoba. The city has many squares where trading is done and markets are held continuously. There are in all districts of this great city many temples or houses for their idols. Among these temples, there is the principal one whose great size and magnificence no human tongue could describe, for it is so large that within the precincts a town of some 500 inhabitants could easily be built. It's 1517. The Caribbean and Panama had just been conquered a few years ago. The main center of power of the Spanish Empire in America is Cuba, governed by the stern and ambitious Diego Velázquez. Velázquez had transformed Cuba into a moderately prosperous colony, however the riches the Spanish expected to find remain a mere illusion. The natural solution to this problem is more exploration and more expansion. In 1517, Velázquez commissions a small fleet led by Francisco Hernández de Córdoba to explore the mainland and, if possible, bring back slaves and gold. Córdoba sails west and discovers the Yucatán Peninsula. The Spanish are astonished by what they find. The Yucatán is inhabited by Mayan peoples, who are a far cry from the Stone Age culture of the Taino Indians of the Caribbean. The Mayans live in well-built stone houses, they have a sophisticated religion, worshipping at large pyramid-shaped temples, and they have advanced forms of agriculture and industry. Finally, the Spanish have found what they were looking for. Córdoba tries to make contact with the Mayans, however, at every instance his men are ambushed and the expedition ends in a complete disaster. But Velázquez is not dismayed. In 1518, he assembles another fleet, placing it under the direction of Juan Grijalva. Grijalva's instructions are clear. He should open trade, but he must abstain from founding a permanent settlement. Velázquez wants to do this himself, in order to reap all the profit and all the glory this might entail. Grijalva follows his instructions to the letter. As he sails west, he discovers the island of Cozumel, then rounds the Yucatán Peninsula and heads north along the coast of Mexico. Here he meets with a deputation of ambassadors, who are already waiting for him. The Spanish have no way to communicate with these Indians, however, from the rich gifts of gold they receive, they deduce that these people must be the ambassadors of a powerful empire. Grijalva heads back to Cuba with this priceless news. Meanwhile, Velázquez is already preparing another fleet, much larger than the previous ones. Its commander is Hernán Cortés, a nobleman from Castile who arrived in America in 1504 and became a well-established member of the Spanish elite in Cuba. His instructions are the same as Grijalva's. Trade and capture some slaves, but don't establish a settlement. But unlike Grijalva, Cortés is a very ambitious man. He goes heavily into debt, augmenting his fleet with more ships and more men, announcing publicly that he does in fact intend to found a colony. When Velázquez hears about this, he explodes with rage and revokes Cortés's commission, also ordering his arrest. But by then, Cortés is already on his way, with 11 ships and 600 men. They first land on the island of Cozumel. Cortés expressly forbids his men from harming anyone, trusting in diplomacy instead of force. His approach works and the Indians welcome Cortés into their town. Cortés finds out about two Spaniards who had been shipwrecked several years ago and since then have become integrated into Mayan society. One of them, a man named Aguilar, joins them, the other decides to stay. With Aguilar, the Spanish finally have a reliable interpreter, enabling them to parley with the Indians of the Yucatán. Next, the fleet heads to the river Tabasco to take on further supplies. Here, the Indians have already made up their mind to fight, in spite of Cortés's efforts to appear peaceful. After a hard-fought amphibious landing, the Spanish rout the Indians and occupy their town. However, the next day, a massive force of some 10,000 Indians shows up. The Indians wear cotton cuirasses and are armed with bows, slings, spears, and sword-like implements with razor-sharp obsidian blades. The vast majority of Cortés's men are armed with sword and buckler in the rodeo fashion. There are also a few dozen musketeers and crossbowmen, 16 horsemen and around a dozen cannon. As the battle starts, the Indians fall on the Spanish like angry hornets. Spanish artillery and muskets prove their value, cutting swathes into their densely packed ranks. After the first unsuccessful rush, the Indians decide to keep their distance and shower the invaders with arrows and stones. This takes a heavy toll on the Spanish, wounding many and killing one. Cortés decides that the only way to salvage the situation is to boldly rush forth and attack. This aggressiveness stuns the Indians and they start to fall back. At this decisive moment, Cortés sends in his cavalry to attack them from the rear. These audacious attacks pay off and the Indians leave the field. Cortez loses 2 Spanish soldiers for 800 Indians killed. Following this battle, Cortez does what will become his signature move. He sets all his prisoners free, sending them back with rich gifts and a peace proposal. The Indian chiefs comply and bring Cortez some meager gifts of gold. They apologize for not bringing him more and explain how all their valuables had been stolen by a powerful empire in the north. They also give the Spanish 20 women. One of these women, whom the Spanish call Doña Marina, is a princess from Mexico. She speaks both Mayan and Nahuatl, the language used in the north. Her skills as a translator will prove invaluable later on, with Aguilar translating Spanish to Mayan and Marina translating Mayan to Nahuatl. After taking on provisions, the fleet weighs anchor and heads north, arriving at the island of Ulua. As news of their arrival spreads, a large delegation of Indians headed by persons of high rank arrives. They present Cortes with very valuable gifts and inform him that they are the representatives of the great Moctezuma II, emperor of the vast Aztec domain. Cortes likewise presents the delegates with gifts and tells them that he is merely here to trade and that he would very much like to meet this great Moctezuma. The ambassadors politely refuse him, saying that as he had just arrived, it would be impossible for him to meet their emperor, but nonetheless they are welcome to stay in his country. Next, Cortes makes a frightful display, firing his cannon and showing off Spanish horsemanship. The ambassadors are very impressed and hurry back to their emperor to report what they saw. Tenochtitlan, the capital of this great empire, is situated on man-made islands within the Lake Texcoco, very similar to Venice but even larger, holding hundreds of thousands of people, with massive temples as large as the pyramids of Egypt. The Mexica people who inhabit this city were originally nomads from the north. They arrived in the region of the Mexico Valley in the 14th century and quickly submitted the other city-states of the region. In 1428, the Triple Alliance had been formed between Tenochtitlan, Texcoco, and Tlacopan. This alliance then conquered vast regions of Central America, subjugating hundreds of cities and millions of people. The Aztec Empire is at the height of its power when Cortes arrives, ruling its subjects by fear, waging wars on a yearly basis, sacrificing hundreds of prisoners of war to their many gods. According to Aztec mythology, their ancestors themselves came from the east and had fair skin and beards. The resemblance of Cortes and his small party to these mythological figures is uncanny. Moctezuma is perplexed and cannot decide what to do. After consulting his nobles and his priests, he decides to monitor the situation and wait for further developments. Meanwhile, in the Spanish camp there is more and more discontent. Half of Cortes's men are loyalists of Velázquez. They maintain that Cortes had overstepped his bounds, so they should take what they have and return home. To preempt this, Cortes employs the same legal trick Velázquez had used to gain control in Cuba. The few huts that had been built are declared a colony and Cortes's loyalists elect him their official representative, authorizing him to deal directly with Spain, thus bypassing Velázquez. With his bold stroke, Cortes consolidates his authority, however it also means he is now in open rebellion. Similarly to Balboa, who had done this in Panama, Cortes is also living on borrowed time. He can either prove himself as an able governor, gaining favor with Spain, or face certain death at the hands of Velázquez. Therefore, he decides to march north to further explore these new lands. After several days, the Spanish are met by another delegation. They inform Cortes that they are from Chempoya, the capital city of the Totonacs. Their leader would love to meet Cortes, but due to him being very fat, he was unable to come, therefore Cortes will have to go to Chempoya. As soon as Cortes arrives, he strikes up a friendship with the fat chief, as the Spanish call him. The chief lavishes him with gifts and tells him how he would love to give more, but he and his people are very poor owing to the tyranny and rapaciousness of his Aztec masters. Cortes, being a keen politician, immediately understands where all this is going. He informs the fat chief that he was sent by his emperor to deliver peace and justice to this land. To the great joy of the chief, he promises to look into these abuses of power. But first he needs to build a base from where he could operate. With the help of the Champoyans, a small fortified settlement, Villa Rica de Veracruz, is built a few miles north of the city. As the Spanish settle in, 5 high-ranking tax collectors arrive from Tenochtitlan. The Totonac people of the region look upon these men with great fear and reverence, knowing well that if they disobey them, it will certainly cost them their lives. By a masterstroke, Cortes manages to convince them to arrest the tax collectors and promises he will make sure that no further taxes will be demanded of them. To further reassure them, he even offers to take the prisoners into his personal custody. The people of Champoya and the surrounding cities rejoice and begin to see Cortes as a benevolent liberator. Since Cortes had so easily achieved something so unthinkable, the idea that he and his men might be demigods starts gaining ground. However, unbeknown to the Champoyans, Cortes in fact gave the tax collectors presents and sent them back home unmolested. When Moctezuma hears of this incident, he becomes furious and decides to mobilize his forces, march to the coast and crush the Spanish. A few days later, when the tax collectors arrive unharmed and bearing gifts, he changes his mind and decides to give diplomacy another chance. Meanwhile, Cortes manages to convince his men to give up all the gold they had gathered and send this treasure to the emperor to secure his benevolence. Velázquez finds out about this and attempts to intercept the ship. However, luck is again on Cortes' side and the ship makes it to Spain. After another Aztec delegation arrives, attempting to placate him with rich gifts in the hope that he stays on the coast and doesn't go to Tenochtitlan, Cortes decides to do precisely this. Velázquez's loyalists protest, so Cortes orders all their ships to be scuttled, ensuring there's only one way to go, forward. Thus Cortes gathers up his troops and supplies, and with the help of his Indian allies begins to move inland. To get to Tenochtitlan, however, the Spanish have to cross the land of the Tlaxcala. The Tlaxcalans are a confederation of Indians surrounded on all sides by the Aztec Empire. According to some opinion, the only reason why they weren't conquered is that the Aztecs need a constant supply of prisoners of war to sacrifice to their gods. Every year the Aztecs would come and drag away thousands of Tlaxcalans, leaving death and destruction in their wake. They also denied them such basic goods as salt, a very serious problem in the tropical region. Equipped with this knowledge, Cortes plans to form an alliance with the Tlaxcalans and turn them against the Aztecs. But things don't go the way Cortes intended. The Tlaxcalans think the Spanish are trying to trick them, so they summon all their warriors to arms. Cortes in turn instructs his men to be constantly on guard and vigilant, an order that will be maintained all throughout the campaign. On the 2nd of September, the two armies meet on an empty field. The Tlaxcalans initially send out a couple thousand warriors as a vanguard. The Spanish fall upon them in their characteristic manner, forcing the Indians to flee. This, however, is a trap. The main army of some 40,000 warriors is lying in wait further along a ridge. The Spanish are initially startled by the ambush, but due to their discipline, they quickly form a defensive formation. Cannons, muskets and crossbows inflict terrible slaughter on the dense ranks of Tlaxcalans. A furious close-quarters battle ensues that lasts for an hour. Cortes exploits every mistake the Indians make, using his cavalry as a shock troop. Finally, the Indians retreat after losing thousands of men. The Spanish also lose several soldiers and two horses. Most of their men are wounded and so exhausted that they likewise have to retreat. Cortes takes up a strong defensive position at an abandoned temple. In his signature move, he frees his prisoners, lavishes them with gifts, and sends them back with a peace proposal, arguing that all he wants is free passage through Tlaxcala. The next morning, the Indians return with a negative answer, so Cortes gives them more presents and sends them back with the same proposal. He also orders a detachment to parade around the battlefield to show the Indians just how confident they are. But nothing could be further from the truth. At this point, the Spanish are only interested in survival, knowing well that if they lose, they will be massacred to the last man. With this premise, the two armies again take to the field. The Tlaxcalans are even more numerous, but it quickly becomes apparent that they are much more reluctant than the previous day. After firing their arrows, they charge the Spanish in a desperate and disorganized manner. Since the Spanish are so few, and they are so many, most of them don't even reach the Spanish line, being cut down by cannonballs where they stand. The battle is concluded in the same fashion as the day before, with the Indians abandoning the field. But by this time, the Spanish are in a desperate state, with most of them, including their horses, being wounded. They crawl back to the temple and adopt a strictly defensive position. But the Tlaxcalans are also no better off. After staggering losses, the realization that the Spanish might indeed be mythological creatures starts to dawn on them. Therefore, they consult their priests to decide what to do. The priests conclude that these demigods are powerful indeed, but only during daytime. Therefore, it is decided to attack them at night with 10,000 elite warriors. But the Spanish are constantly on guard, just as Cortes had ordered, and the attack is discovered, negating the element of surprise. The Spanish are well prepared in their defensive positions, and the attack is an even greater failure than the previous day's battle. Cortes again frees his prisoners and sends them back with gifts and a peace proposal. The Tlaxcalans conclude that there is no way they could defeat these strangers, therefore they might as well join them. The Spanish are given supplies and invited to the Tlaxcalan capital. Once here, even Cortes, ever so diplomatic, cannot help notice the sheer poverty of the Tlaxcalans. The chiefs explain that they would gladly give him gold, but all their valuables had been stolen by the Aztecs. On the other hand, if Cortes is truly there to bring peace and justice to the land, they would contribute 10,000 soldiers to his cause. Thus, the Spanish-Tlaxcalan alliance is formed, marking a turning point in the conquest of Mexico. When Moctezuma learns of this alliance, he realizes he can no longer ignore the problem. He sends another embassy, showering the Spanish with gifts and finally inviting them to his capital. With this ploy, he hopes to separate Cortes from his allies and deal with him on a more favorable ground where he would hold all the aces. In October, Cortes is ready to resume his march. He plans to take the direct route to Tenochtitlan through the city of Cholula. Cholula is closely allied with the Aztecs and untrustworthy according to the Tlaxcala. Contrary to their advice, Cortes only takes 2,000 Tlaxcalan warriors, trusting in his own arms and diplomatic abilities. When the Spanish arrive in Cholula, they are wined and dined for 3 days. Gradually, however, the Spanish perceive that the Choluans are giving them the cold shoulder. Cortes receives intelligence that large bodies of Aztec and Choluan soldiers are waiting to ambush them as soon as they leave the city. It's not clear if these allegations were actually true, but nonetheless Cortes decides to take preemptive action. He orders all the prominent people of the city to assemble. After confronting them with his accusations, he attacks them, killing many and burning down a large part of the city. After this massacre, a groveling delegation of Choluans begs Cortes for peace, promising him eternal loyalty. Cortes is happy to oblige. Moctezuma also sends a delegation, assuring Cortes that they had no part in the plot and welcoming them again to Tenochtitlan. A few days later, another delegation arrives, showering Cortes with gifts and asking him not to come to Tenochtitlan. This weak and indecisive diplomacy encourages Cortes even more, and on the 8th of September 1519, the Spanish enter Tenochtitlan. Moctezuma decides to make the best of the situation and warmly embraces Cortes in front of a large crowd. Cortes in turn gives all due respect to the emperor, professing friendship and love for him and his people. The Spanish are housed in one of the royal palaces next to Moctezuma's quarters. They are wined and dined with great extravagance, and Cortes has several courteous meetings with Moctezuma. The Spanish even find a room full of treasure that appears to have been planted there for them to find. But as the days go by, this festive atmosphere begins to sour. The turning point comes when the Spanish insist that a Christian cross be erected atop the main temple. This request is flatly refused, and the Spanish start to realize just how small and vulnerable they are in comparison to Tenochtitlan and the Aztec Empire. When word is received that a group of Spaniards whom they left back at Veracruz was ambushed and killed, and that the Totonacs had once again submitted to the Aztecs, the men become panicky. In their characteristic manner, the Spanish decide to solve this problem with a bold stroke and turn a potential defeat into victory. Their plan is to kidnap Moctezuma. Since the emperor's palace is close by and Moctezuma never keeps bodyguards in his throne room and receiving Cortes, the plan actually works. As he is transferred to the Spanish compound, Moctezuma fails to cry out for help, as this would cause him to lose face. Cortes' plan is to keep up all appearances as if the emperor was a free man, all the while ordering Moctezuma to do his bidding. First he asks the emperor to declare himself a vassal of Charles V. Then he asks for all the treasure in the empire to be brought to him. Then he asks for the man who killed the Spaniards at Veracruz to be killed in turn. Moctezuma sheepishly complies, but this is too much for his subjects to bear, who are now very close to revolt. When the Spanish believe things couldn't get worse, the unthinkable happens. 1,400 Spanish soldiers sent by Velázquez to arrest Cortes land at Veracruz. The force is led by Panfilio Narváez, a boastful nobleman who will stop at nothing to undermine Cortes. He sends a message to the Aztecs, saying that Cortes is in fact a bandit and a pirate who escaped from Spain and whose arrest had been ordered by the Emperor Charles himself. Sensing the gravity of the situation, Cortes immediately goes into action. He sets out with a force of 260 men to defeat Narváez. Around 200 Spaniards under the command of Pedro de Alvarado are left behind in Tenochtitlan to guard the treasure and Moctezuma. To ease his way, Cortes sends emissaries laden with treasure into Narvaez's camp. Narvaez, being extremely avaricious, had already alienated a large number of his men and the Indians of Champoya. When these soldiers see how generous Cortes is, their fighting spirit begins to ebb, with some deserting to Cortes and others acting as spies. When Cortes launches a ferocious night attack, most of Narvaez's men surrender without much of a fight. With this daring coup, Cortes just tripled his force at very little cost to himself. Now, at the head of 1400 soldiers, Cortes begins his forced march back to Tenochtitlan. But when he reaches Tlaxcala, he is welcomed with grave news. All of Mexico had risen up, and Alvarado is currently being besieged in Tenochtitlan. According to Alvarado, the Aztec priests and nobility were plotting against the Spanish under the guise of a religious celebration. To preempt this, Alvarado covertly surrounded them and massacred a great number of prominent people, all of whom were unarmed. Cortes is greatly dismayed by this news and rushes back to Tenochtitlan with his 1400 troops as well as 2000 Tlaxcalan warriors. They manage to rejoin with Alvarado, however, as soon as the Spanish are in their compound, the Aztecs block all streets and avenues and destroy the bridges leading out of the city. The Spanish are now trapped. The Indians launch furious assaults against them, and with every day that goes by, their position becomes increasingly untenable. Cortes orders Moctezuma to go out on the ramparts to calm his people down. But by this time, Moctezuma's authority is gone. As he tries to speak, he is hit by a spear and is mortally wounded. Now the last chance to resolve things peacefully is gone. The Spanish need to get out fast, but this is easier said than done. On the night of June the 30th, 1520, Cortes forms his army into three divisions. His plan is to stealthily cross the western causeway, the shortest one, and make his escape that way. He constructs a mobile bridge that he intends to move from one gap to another as his army marches along the causeway. Heavily laden with treasure, the Spanish and Tlaxcalans begin their evacuation. But as soon as they get to the first gap, they are discovered. Suddenly, tens of thousands of Aztec warriors descend on them, some along the causeway, others over the watering canoes. As the mobile bridge collapses, all discipline breaks down. Now every man has to fight for himself. All of the artillery and most of the treasure is lost, with hundreds drowning or being killed on the causeway. The slaughter continues outside the city, with large Aztec armies in hot pursuit. At Otumba, a massive army awaits the Spanish in an open field. But these men have never seen Spanish cavalry in action. Going all in, Cortes launches his cavalry straight at the Aztec general, throwing the entire army into chaos. The Spanish manage to break through. However, by the time they reach safety in Tlaxcala, only 440 Spaniards remain out of 1600. The Noche Triste, or Sad Night, is the lowest point of Cortes' campaign. But Cortes, being as he is, refuses to back down. He renews his alliance with the Tlaxcala and sets about restoring his credibility. A number of Spanish and Tlaxcalan stragglers had been murdered by the cities surrounding Tenochtitlan. Cortes sends out several detachments to deal with these city-states one by one. He is greatly aided in this by constant supplies arriving to Veracruz. Velázquez, being ignorant of Narváez's defeat, is still sending supplies. Settlers from a failed colony join Cortes, and other supplies arrive from Spain. Despite great efforts, the Aztecs lose more and more allies. To compound these problems, disease and famine start to decimate their numbers. Smallpox arrived in Mexico with Narváez's men and is now ravaging Indians who have no innate immunity to it. The great urban center of Tenochtitlan is hit especially hard. With his enemy weakened and his credibility restored, Cortes lays out the plans for 13 shallow-bottomed brigantines to be later transported and assembled on the lake. On December the 25th, 1520, Cortes leaves Tlaxcala with around 950 soldiers and 10,000 Tlaxcalan allies. He marches to the city of Texcoco, a junior member of the Triple Alliance. The chiefs of Texcoco flee, and Cortes occupies the city that will serve as a base for the next stage of the campaign. As Cortes waits for his boats, he is challenged by several Aztec armies, numbering in the tens of thousands. The fiercest battles are fought to the south, around Charco. If the Mexica lose this city, the way will be open to Tenochtitlan. But nothing can stop Cortes. With his boats finally assembled, the Spanish descend on Tenochtitlan. Around 350 Spanish man the 13 brigantines. Three equal divisions of 200 men each, made up of swordsmen, crossbowmen, musketeers and cavalry, are led by Pedro de Alvarado, Cristobal de Olid and Gonzalo de Sandoval. These are each backed up by 8,000 Indian allies. The siege begins on May the 10th, 1521. Alvarado and Olid move to the west of Tenochtitlan, cutting off the aqueducts to the city. Sandoval is first sent to besiege Iztapalapan in the south, then he is transferred north to assault the Tepeaquila causeway. Meanwhile, Cortes, at the head of his small navy, assaults a fortified island. The Aztecs try to overwhelm them, attacking with thousands of canoes at once, but Cortes's superior ships beat back every assault. Meanwhile, Alvarado probes the defenses of the western causeway. But the Aztecs easily beat them back, attacking simultaneously on land and water. Seeing this, Cortes orders his ships to reinforce his men, standing guard on both flanks of the causeway as the soldiers advance. To counter this, the Aztecs plant stakes in the lake bottom, immobilizing the Spanish ships, making them more vulnerable to attack. One night, two ships sent out to patrol the lake are drawn into such a trap. One brigantine is destroyed, and many Spanish are killed. Later, Cortes also lays an ambush for the Indians waiting to ambush him. The ambushers are destroyed, and the Aztecs never attempt to attack the Spanish ships again. Seeing these successes of the Spanish, the remaining allies of Dominica defect to Cortes. The Spanish continue their advance along the causeways, making steady but difficult progress. Each time they advance, the Aztecs launch a counterattack. The Spanish decide to systematically demolish the houses along the causeways to deny their enemy all cover. Cavalry is of little use in this conflict, however, artillery proves to be priceless. The long and straight causeways prove to be ideal killing fields, where each shot finds hundreds of targets. On June the 24th, the Aztecs muster all their forces and launch simultaneous attacks against the Spanish. Alvarado is in great danger of being overwhelmed, but his artillery holds the front while his Indian allies guard the rear. Drunk with success, Cortes makes a big mistake 1 week later. He orders a general attack by all three Spanish columns designed to push all the way to the temples, destroying the Aztecs by one bold stroke. He himself leads the southern division and heroically pushes deep inside the city. But the Aztec retreat turns out to be a ruse. Cortes and his men are separated from their ships and Indian allies as thousands of Aztec warriors surround them. 65 Spanish soldiers are captured and Cortes barely manages to get away. Emboldened by their success, the Aztecs continue their relentless attacks for days. As war drums resound all over the city, the Spanish captives are sacrificed one by one at the top of the Great Temple, in full view of their luckier comrades. This gruesome spectacle so disheartens Cortes's Indian allies that most of them decide to leave. This is the second low point in Cortes's career, but in his characteristic manner, he overcomes this issue too. He orders his men to strictly focus on blockading the city from now on. His navy is likewise sent to patrol the lake and prevent any communication with the shore. Seeing Cortes's dogged determination and his ability to turn defeat into victory, his Indian allies come back in even greater numbers than before. Weeks of blockade eventually take their toll, and the defenders become observably weaker. At the end of July, Cortes orders another general attack. After several days of careful siege warfare, the Spanish finally reach the temples on the 1st of August. The defenders retreat to the north of the city, the only place not under Spanish control. Several days of peace negotiation follow, but this is only meant to stall for time, allowing as many people to escape as possible. On the 13th of August, 1521, the Emperor Cuauhtémoc also tries to escape by canoe. The Spanish ships spot this attempt, intercepting the canoes and capturing the Emperor of the Aztecs. The 93-day siege of Tenochtitlan is over.